Okay, our next speaker is Thomas. He's a teacher at a school in Bavaria. That is very normal, I guess, but he podcasts as well. He does podcasts, and some of you may know the politics lessons in which he talks about politics or rants about the German education system. And of course, there was quite a lot that you could rant about regarding digitalization in schools. That applied to me as I was looking after an 8th grade student. So next to the things that didn't go too well, maybe there were a few positive things. And what you could take into school reality, which is always changing from this turbulent year. And that's what Thomas has thought a lot about, and that's what he's going to share with us. And I'm looking forward to that. And a very warm virtual welcome to you, Thomas. The stream is yours. Thank you.
Dankeschön.
Hi. Hallo. Welcome. This is my digital classroom. That is new.
Das haben wir seit diesem Jahr.
But everyone has one now. This year.
Wir haben also digitale Schule.
Digital school.
So. Und ich hatte eigentlich im Vorfeld.
In advance of all this happening, which we will come to, I actually had some involvement in the topic already. And that's what we'll get to now. So January 2020, everyone was talking about digitalization in schools, which meant everyone would buy computers for schools and digitalize all kinds of processes. And you talk about digitality in educational science.
Der Schule, das heißt also,
so the idea that all these things that we have, and of course we have talked about them often at Congress, the things that create a digital reality,
und die Politik hat
which politics has often accompanied with funds, you know, from the 80s and 90s and early 2000s, no program called Schulen ans Netz, so schools into the network or to the network. And now we have a didactical or pedagogical work world where the digital cannot be ignored anymore. I'm from Bavaria. In the federal state of Bavaria, we have a law that says that digital storage media are not allowed to be used in school, but at the same time, we are supposed to have lessons with Wi-Fi routers, mobiles, and everything. So, digitality is coming in slowly but surely. And I do sometimes tell my students to take out their smartphones and do a poll for me. Let's stay in January and look at the foundations that we were talking about in didactics, media, education science, as much talked about technology, how do I teach people to use technology, media competency in the technical sense.
And also
the question was, what do I do with that? How do I use this technology, for example, the one that we use right now, what does that all mean? And then there is this debate of about what the added value is actually. If I have a smart board, is that really better than the classic whiteboard? And, well, these kinds of debates are often portrayed as tedious or not. I think they're not really tedious, because the question of how to use digital media is also the question about which advantages I have. And a foundation that we might talk about at first is the model that I'm showing you in the slide, the SAMR model, substitution, augmentation, modification, and redefinition are the four letters. What you see here is the German variant, very nicely prepared. You have the English letters at the top and the German terms at the bottom, very confusing, and digital devices.
Und die erste Variante, die ich benutzen kann, ist substitution.
talking about digital devices, the first thing I can use is substitution. So something I have already done in an analog way, I now do digitally.
So
putting away my overhead projectors and use a digital camera instead. Nothing changes in the way the lesson goes. Although, well, that is actually not quite true, because that could be regarded as augmentation.
Use a projector
and project a picture onto the wall with that. That gives me a better quality than using the old overhead projector. And augmentation would be expanding the thing, and that is what the digital camera would be, because I now can take documents and work with them.
Ja, also with my students, Schülerinnenleistung mir geben lassen, legt die unter die Kamera, kann
I can put something under the camera. Normally people would have to write on transparent foils,
as soon as the
special pen was used, everything will be over. And I can use any paper, and of course with smart boards I can use animations on my board, which is fantastic and exciting if you want to do this. So that's augmentation.
Und das ist
so
halt
an expansion of the didactic tools that I have. Regarding modification, actually changing didactical worlds, that's level 3, as it were, that is something
etwas, da wird's dann geil,
nerds would find really exciting.
Ein gutes Beispiel habe ich,
and an example here, there is presentation software these days with which you can
live im
ask the students to submit polls, which is also privacy protected. So as a teacher in social science, I can run a poll about any issue and I will get an anonymized survey result. So the students will know, okay, this is how I can reply without any consequences. And at the same time, I can find out
what wie denn so ein
the other people think, the other students, about an issue. So that's something that wasn't possible before. You used to have a scale of opinions where you would ask people to stand according to what they believe. And of course, you have the terms of social stigma and social desirability. You would have fewer people putting themselves in a faraway corner. So this is a clear modification. And then redefinition, that is interesting because technically that is not possible. I cannot, using technology, redefine something because no software and hardware actually exists that isn't based on an idea from classical teaching.
So
I have to imagine something different and then build it. I cannot use things that have been built already and do things that I haven't been able to imagine yet. So there is a fundamental problem here.
So
this is for didactics, for dealing with digital media, there's a lot of optimism in the debate.
But
the big new invention often leads up to people simply recording something on their smartphone and that's it. And I've talked about this when I was talking
aber es ist halt auch nicht so
about modification, but the really big leap isn't there. We are not revolutionizing, but evolutionizing. Now, the big issue, of course, has always been data protection. So much so that many education scientists said they were not going to think about this anymore. But we as teachers are facing huge problems. I had to hand out about 3 to 4 privacy statements to students for them to sign so that they could use what we are going to use. GDPR is a good thing. There's no need to discuss it, particularly not at Congress, but
the problem is
that many things do not minimize data, and there are many ways
to abuse students' private data and information
about problems with reading or orthography end up on databases that are often not secured. And then there were offensives, so programs, initiatives from various institutions. So I filled in a form from an initiative by the Bavarian Educational Ministry.
And
many people, they tried to introduce to the use of digital media. My school started a sequence of trainings about various tools that could be used there, and all that is in the augmentation area, really.
Ja, also das so war so that was
the foundation
im Januar.
In
wir sind
January,
also so im
we
Laufen
were
gewesen.
On the way,
ja,
trotting along
wir haben uns da
and
immer
approaching all this
so
didactically.
So
now, administration did discover digitalization,
ja, das
and
heißt,
suddenly we had
ganz viele
many tools
zur
for administering,
ja, alles
schools or
cloud-based, ja, also cloud-basiert im Sinne von,
in the sense of PHP, MySQL, somewhere. Now, currently, suddenly we have messengers that are privacy conformant, digital timetables, but the problem is,
man hat halt
it's not all on a single platform. Various state projects exist, and we'll have a look at some or rather of these. Every federal state in Germany has its own learning platform. There is NEBIS used in Bavaria. Many states have some Moodle. The northern state of Schleswig-Holstein
had
the issue that they clicked themselves a platform somewhere and then called it SH-learning, and we were all laughing. All these things exist, and the whole thing is very disparate, and contrary to what you would expect, there is not a single official project, not even a federal state, that would encompass everything in Bavaria. I know that there's been work for a long time to do something like that, but they still haven't finished it. And we hope for big things there, but it's also in the hand of the schools, which software they opt for, or in the hands of the communal school administration. And, of course, it depends on the budget of the school or the commune. So, regarding digitalization, we are now at a place where there are so many tools all flying around, and every school is trying to pick something out of that whole cloud of
offers
and is doing its best, and you find that no solution is optimal because, as you know from software, there never is the optimal solution. So that's how digitalization works. That happens
up
to the point where some real data loss occurs. And of course, that also is just a question of time. Right. We have to talk about the digital pact of school.
Okay, the digital pact, there's 23 million of the 5 billion have been used until June, and they've been paid out. And what's the reason for this? Easy answer is all the federal states had to make clear who will get what, and there's a problem with the constitution. And in my school, I had to make a media curriculum to write down what we are doing already with digital media, so that now we get good equipment, and for my school we really got some equipment. And starting in November, in the digital pact with the last extension, there is now the idea has been enshrined that you get money for administrators. And of course, we asked ourselves why it took so long that they got the idea, because, well, the problem with the software and the hardware is not buying it, but the problem is administration. And the old project where putting schools on the network, that hardware was bought and software, and nobody was there to set it up or administrate it. But normally, just one teacher gets a few hours per week. This is like paid overtime, paid additional time for working that. It's better to let administrate it by someone who really knows about it, and the teacher usually can't really do that. Teachers are experts for English or politics, and certainly not for administrating networks or something like that. And March, of course, there was beer. And so 15th of March, 15th of March, I can still remember in our school, all the beamers, all the projectors were running, saying there's no class today and the schools were closed. There's the main news TV show and the schools were closed and we thought for how long? It turned out it was 6 weeks and then we switched over to digital. And on the 16th of March, Mebis was down. That's the Bavarian school, remote school platform. And it says here there was an automated attack, automatic calling up of pages. And I don't think it was automated. I think it was manual. Because it was a school system, which means Monday morning at 8 o'clock, lots of schools told their students, dear children, now there is a digital distance learning, please call up this website. And they did that. And I think it was really, it was still a denial of service, but it wasn't automated. And a new service were bought quickly. And it really says a lot about this learning platform. And it that it fell down means that it wasn't used a lot before that, and we are talking about that a bit later. So the first 6 weeks, March until end of April, mid-May, something like that, and the German school system, we have lots of learned about the reality of digital distance learning, and schools had the problem that suddenly the communication, the means of communications were confusing or were non-existent. Suddenly you had emails or you had messengers or telephone chains and things like that. And of course, many colleagues just didn't have any concept for that, including me. And there was a thing, lots of teachers really had to create new material very quickly, and material that are adapted to materials were originally adapted for face-to-face classes, and now students had to do that by themselves at home, and it's not easy. The competencies were not there with the teachers, and that's including myself. There was a very steep learning curve. We had to look at it. Competencies at the students were also missing, and the administration too were lacking the competencies, and the parents as well, who also had to. And of course, everybody was on Zoom suddenly, and no longer. But in Bavaria, we could only do that if it was an official disaster. Then you can neglect privacy. But after that, it was a problem again. Zoom, of course, was the reality in a lot of schools. And that sums it up. For the parents, they had a communication overload because the system thought, okay, well, you have six classes of 45 minutes every day, and you get a task for that. And pedagogically, that's far too much. And my experience was that to distribute one task over 4 hours, I have more grown-up students, and of course they need a lot more time to absorb the information and, of course, have a problem. Sometimes they don't have internet, but they have Zoom, and they don't have webcams. And a colleague told me that she had a technology class. Those were the nerds, and they didn't have webcams because their gaming PC doesn't have a webcam. And the parents were the substitute teachers, and suddenly the didactical and pedagogical competencies of the parents were needed, and they are very disparate. And you really have to say some can do it and some can do it less. And it's very, very demanding at home. The room, the space is important to make the children understand that they have to learn. And parents were overwhelmed. And on the one hand, the teachers can say, okay, now they they now they see why we are here. And on the other hand, of course, parents shouldn't be subjected to these situations, and you have to find a way to connect the teachers to the students. And of course, that didn't really happen, and everybody was having problems. So we learned that schools and parents were overwhelmed, and schools are important for education and for also for caring for the children. And people laughed at that, but I didn't find that very very funny. And we are talking about presence classes or distance learning, and this is really important. I heard teachers say, I am not I don't have to care for the children, and but we are not like parents, but we don't give them something to play, but we give them math tasks. But they are in a room with one person minding them, which aren't their parents, but of course it's similar to that. But maybe we come back to that later. But please, if you look at school and looking at minding the children and educating the children are different things, and it's you can't really separate it entirely. And digital learning deepens social disparities, social differences. If you don't have academics, if you have academics at home as parents, it's quite different. It's different if your parents have system-relevant jobs and aren't at home. But I found a magical document here. If you want to contact your students, use any messenger you like. But please, as if you use a messenger, use Signal because that's encrypted. So I was asked how many classes I would have to do during the pandemic and how much I could prepare, and that meant that my students really took their social sciences lessons via the podcast, for example, and that was possible suddenly. And what was also possible, some schools started using paper again, because that was also flattening the differences, the social differences and the education differences, because if I make a telephone chain, one parent for one class picks up a stack of paper and distributes it. And especially if I don't have any digital means and students don't have the access to digital means, then paper can be a good solution. It looks funny, maybe, especially if I talk about it, about digital school, but you have to be pragmatic. And what do we want? Do we do equal education, or do we really digital first, and the digital has to be there on both ends, and that's a problem of equality. And so the new school year is coming on, and the captain here is completely right. The presence learning is there, shields up, full reverse, and all these liberties, all these freedoms were turned back, and now we're doing presence classes again, and now we have these three variants. Presence learning is important. Well, it's important. It's the standard model. It's what we've all learned. So, of course, that's what people imagine when they think of school. That's a weak argument. But it makes the social differences more equal, and because it's separated from the parents, it levels the social differences. Yes, and now we have a three layered school system where there are differences. So if we had an integrated school, that would be a much stronger argument. But we have a better social control. And we can control them better, we can control the parents better in the sense that we can maybe see abuse that happens in the family. And of course, we can control the colleagues better if that they really, really do their work. Otherwise, we're just sitting at our computers and get bored. And so that's a hierarchical system, well balanced, and presence classes are great. They've always been there. And Mr. Söder, the Interior Minister, the Minister, Prime Minister in Bavaria, said that as well. And I'm also old school in a way, because in some ways it is quite efficient, not exactly effective, but it can be efficient. And it is sometimes you have project work and so on. And it is quite rigid, and we have 45 minutes classes, and it changes all the time. There's very little flexibility in the system, and you could do something about that. Distance learning.
We have talked about distance learning. Parents are now given tasks. And, well, we as a school should be looking after the children so that the parents go to work in the capitalist society. So, distance learning, parents are not really in a position really to take over these tasks, and distance learning is often overloaded with content, and there is little feeling of how quickly or slowly children learn if they do the work on their own. So we have no socialization for that, both on the side of teachers and students. It's very hard to estimate, and the threat, the danger that people, students are overloaded is high. Content has to be taken back. That's something I personally had to get used to as well. Now, close supervision or caring from teachers is not possible that much. Video conference isn't very useful, unless you have good eye contact, maybe, but that's limited. And the interaction has its own value as well. There are many technical hurdles there. It's not just students that do not, may not have powerful enough computers. Many teachers don't have them or are not very good in dealing with that technology. They may have privacy concerns as well and other similar issues. And, of course, it's very hard to log the effort with the administration. If I take time to prepare extra time, can I log that? Can I record that as work time? Can I say this was distance learning? We may have been in a video conference, but I then gave them a task to work on, and that's what they did. So the time that you normally spend in the class, is that now time at home that you can record as work time? And someone might get nervous about it. But now the solution for that has been called hybrid teaching. And the idea is that half of the students are in the room and the other half are connected. I have given you a example a calculation here. This picture is a school with 1,000 students. That's about 45 classes. And a video call, according to Microsoft Zoom BigBlueButton, is about 500 kilobits per second, up to 1 megabit per second. At least that's what I found. So I need about 50 megabits per second, megabits per second upstream, and it has to be reliable to get such a school connected. That is ambitious, not every school has that. And putting a computer and a connection and a microphone as such in every classroom is another issue, so the technical side is difficult already. But that's not the main counter-argument, because the problem is that didactically this is a catastrophe. Speaking from practical experience, that's what I do. Imagine in front of you, you have students. Next to you, you have a computer. And if you're lucky, it records students just in the way you see me right now, and you have to focus on both these. And you have just one microphone, because we don't want cameras in the classroom. You have to interact. I saw on Twitter that someone thought, well, we have this one person who was a continual risk patient.
Und die hatte dann irgendwie ein großes gesehen hat, dass die Person halte ich für eine praktische Lösung, aber das ist
so that can be the reality of hybrid lessons.
So, kann ich da machen?
Worksheets I hand out.
Wobei, wenn ich das
if I hand it out digitally, I have to ask myself, why do I actually connect the people? Well, they can respond to me,
but
I can't hand out the work. If I can't hand out the digital worksheet to everyone, why do I have even students sitting in front of me? There's another question, and the interaction between those in the room and those in the connection isn't really there.
It all uses
the teacher as a pivot,
and so you have a
didactical step back, really, from fairly open methods to something that's very much focused on the teacher, just as you get in video conferences, of course. So that is terrible. It's very hard to keep attention, and running a lesson like that compared to presence teaching, but also compared to a fully digital distance teaching, is something that isn't really good at all. It doesn't give you much progress, and there's very little that you can do. I teach the upper years, we do complex things in our lessons. That's what we want to do. We want the people to gain in competency, work together. Well, we have a pandemic, we can't really work in groups, but you could have a breakout room. The digital adaptation of the classroom to what we are used to, just by having an MS Teams or whatever connection, that from the point of view of the school system is a step back in terms of didactic methods. It is terrible and a terrible experience for the students, and it's an indicator that we are trying to push things into a system that is currently breaking. We have to get more flexible due to the pandemic, and we have to have people's pure students separated but still well looked after, so we can't have one half sitting around for half of the time. We have to restructure everything completely, rethink school completely, and think about digital distance learning, and we have to ask what is actually our objective, because many things are possible digitally. So digital school fails from lack of imagination.
Dann kann ja nicht dieser Hybridunterricht sein.
So we cannot do hybrid lessons so much, but we cannot do distance teaching in 45 minute intervals. So
mir geht das ja gar nicht
I can't quite get my head around this. I ask myself, what drive me and my students to sit at these computers at 8 every morning? Why? Where is the sense? Where is the added value? I kept asking myself. I have a learning platform. Every school has one. There's the Bavarian one and the second one that we use. So learning platforms exist. I can put everything in there. A very luxurious, for teachers, it is a very luxurious thing. I can put tasks in, they pop up. I receive my solutions. I can see who's looked at what.
Well,
if you are a control freak, you can see who is working on that precise.
Also warum sollen
should people want to join a video conference all the time? I have no idea. I don't have to be there. The heads of the school don't have to be there. The students don't have to be there. Why? Simply because some people exist that cannot look beyond timetables.
So
this is something I can break up.
And we could
introduce time sovereignty. This is something you know. There are people that cannot work well early in the morning. Nerd people are enthusiastic now. People that are able to start coding from 10 p.m., we could finally cater for them. I myself, I'm a morning person, so I am not the guy to do that. But not everyone can be present at 8 o'clock and be present. And we know that some people actually drop off by 9 a.m. So let's leave that to the students themselves. We can have a flipped classroom. Flipped classrooms. That is when students work into the subjects themselves and do the tasks and the review with the teachers. That is what I do in my social science lessons. Elaborate the issue as a podcast or have it somewhere outside.
Ja, aber and I can send
people to YouTube, and that has the advantage that I, as a teacher, can self-reflect more and realize what I can explain not so well, what the topics are that make me feel a bit uncomfortable, and everyone has those. So I can send these people to a good YouTube video done by someone else.
Digital school
also allows a closer, caring relationship, because I can have one-on-one conferences. I can take that time. I can structure my day flexibly.
But
that is a contradiction to all those timetable and control logics that are ingrained in schooling, because you have to prove somehow that you've spent this and that amount of time to educate children. A certain number of English lessons, for example, have to be recorded. Otherwise, you have no real proof of education, right? We haven't talked about proving your results. And there is no way to have tests or anything that does not use paper, because everything else could be faked. And the tasks that I would set, if people had the internet available, students with a school kind of education are prepared to solve the kind of tasks that we give them, and with all the complexity of the internet, you would have to set tasks that they could not solve. But digital school on its own isn't a solution either. I have colleagues from the math section, for example, that say, I have it. No gain from that, because you have to have someone asking questions and pointing them to look at certain things again. I was doing private tutoring in maths for the years where I can do it, and yes, the important thing is to have someone stand there and say, come on, this is not the correct result. You have a minus sign that's missing there. And point people to something. So this needs a personal relationship, a personal situation, and learning platforms won't help you much there either. Highly complex worksheets could be made, but not everyone can do that. The independence of students is actually a higher burden as well. With a school experience, school routine, it's very difficult to work on your own with your own timing, because you don't learn that. In the first year, you enter school and you are told all the time, now this is learning that is not controlled by yourself. You have the teacher. Then there are concepts such as Montessori. They are more independent. That works better. And if people are used to that, it works better. The students I am used to have a very different routine, and they think what the teacher says is correct, that I can rely on. And there are people that in their upbringing fail in both ways. They may burn out, or they may not do enough. And to get a feel for that, what is the thing, what can I manage? How do I have to structure my time? We have no answers for that at the moment, and it has never been part of the school system, showing people that social interaction is important for this kind of socialization. So for children in elementary school years, but also the first years afterwards, it's very important for them to have social interaction. Being a teenager is social interaction in the peer group, and that, of course, isn't happening either these days. So we need to create rooms where, despite a digital school, this kind of interaction can take place. And we still have the task of looking after the parents, because it's about the economy. But this care work is more. Different institutions
are
teachers, social workers, peer groups in a safe space. That is important. So we cannot simply switch to fully digital because it's good and flexible, but in the digital space we can take on the flexibility of learning if the students have had some education on that, which often they haven't had. So everything is kind of two-sided, And what we can take away is that hybrid lessons are quite useless. If I am supposed to do hybrid teaching, I have to go to that teacher and ask them, okay, what do you want to do? What does your lesson look like you're teaching? These are the options you have. And then give them the flexibility to say, these colleagues can say, in my subject, I need high social interaction, but we have the pandemic, so I need divided groups. So I'll have two groups every day. Personally present teaching with distance rules and everything, and at the same time someone like me can be told, well, you are teaching subjects such as English or social sciences where people can learn independently, or maybe they need personal interaction for a while, so we can tell these people will take these lesson hours away from you, you don't need as many as of those. You meet in a video chat for conversation in English, for example, in the evenings and for a meeting, for a review, but these flexibilities are not there. Either we have timetables or not, presence is important and all that, and that is the big dilemma.
And that brings us to the 13th of December 2020, and presence learning collides with reality. We went into the Christmas holidays, and I haven't heard anyone say that it starts back up on the 10th of January, but I have a citation from someone, a quote from someone who thinks that it will happen, but the technical means have been improved, but only partially, but everybody else needed headsets and so on and so forth, and the rules have only been adapted slightly and partially. So how to find the grades, how to come up with grades and so on, and qualification, and it's a part of school and it's still important. And we didn't care about that, and we thought we always do some presence learning, and if they go into quarantine, then we do hybrid classes or distance classes, and nobody thought about that there would be another complete lockdown, so students cannot be there, and now there are studies that schools are actually more dangerous than we thought so far, because that's a big problem for the economy, because of the supervision of the students. So we really wasted the time. Yeah. But school systems are in a federal country, their system changes slowly. It's how it is. It is very slow. But what do we do now? There's only flexibility in the school system if everything has already broken. Then it works. It's a bit sad, really. I had hoped for more, but all right. And we have this, we haven't extended our advantage for digital and organizational. Instead, now we have contracts with Microsoft. And Italy went along and bought Google Classroom, and there was a problem in Germany, and there were complaints about the GDPR, and I looked at Google Classroom. That's really great stuff, but you sell your data to Google, so that's not possible in Germany, and according to the GDPR, that's not possible. And maybe that's not a bad thing, but in the end, the internal know-how isn't there, and it's not really wanted either, and we are really going along with Captain Lorca there. We may go back to presence classes again. And the only place where we really used digitalization very well is the idea that you can better control the teachers and the students. That was accepted very quickly, and the administration platforms are really good when I enter the grades and if I really did my classes and give me more tasks to do and expect more from me and the students. And there will always be messages and so on, and that is digitalization in the administration. And what hasn't been made more flexible are timetables and classes and grades and evidence for grades and so on. And what has been made flexible is my work time, because people expect me even on a Sunday to work, to reply to an email at 10 p.m. on a Sundays and react to that. That can't really be the sense of that. I don't want to complain. We get a good wages and so on. But even companies say that you don't have to reply to emails after your work hours. So, but you say, the means are there now, why can't you just send a quick message and so on?
And
so for students it's perhaps even worse. I have mostly adult students, and it's really dangerous if not you really look for a discourse. And the last thing is, I heard lots of projects where people from nerd circles looked after hardware and software, and we can be so glad that these nerds are there and that they helped, and that chaos works like that, and chaos helps schools and so on. But now, since you are in front of your machines now, I hope there's an applause now for this creative chaos and for the nerds that helped. And this is my last slide. The 28th of December this year, this is the Minister for Education of Baden-Württemberg, and she said that presence classes cannot be replaced with anything, and I'll have a counter suggestion, and presence classes can be replaced by digitalized classes where parts can be in presence. When it is useful for that, and if it should really be reduced to nothing, but there are some things supervision has to be maintained, and economic pressures are much more important even than educational pressures, but a more flexible, a more digitalized classes and new tasks and students learning to learn by themselves, that would be a lot better. And that would be the school that trains students to have competencies, to develop competencies. And that politicians always wanted that as a goal for the schools. And these are goals that we can reach this way. But and those things can replace large parts of presence classes. And now my 45 minutes school lesson is over. I thank you for your attention. And okay.
Okay, ja, danke.
Ja, vielen Dank, Thomas, für
diese tolle Einblicke, soll ich dir sagen.
Es for these wonderful insights. And thank you very much.
IRC und eine sehr lebendige Diskussion.
The discussion has been lively. And there is one question that you may or may not want to answer. What school do you teach at?
This is a
vocational training upper school, so that we are kind of Berufsgymnasium, to use the German term.
Wir haben nämlich noch eine ganze Menge Fragen an dich hier, die wir gesammelt haben. Ja, es ist alles entspannt. Wir fangen mal entspannt an. Es gab nämlich die Frage,
welche Software is actually used for distance learning.
Also, ob du da
can you name some products? Well, firstly, we have a nice pointer because I have a podcast called Lernfragen, Learning Questions in English. And we have Maha's Lead Culture podcast where I talk with Maha, a very well-known German speaker. And the schools in Germany use a lot of Moodle. This open learning platform, Bavaria uses Mebis, which is a clone. And my school, Form, uses its Learning Fronter, a professional solution.
Halt, das ist eine kommerzielle Lösung. Und da gibt's mehrere Sachen.
There are various things there. I think the weapon of choice in the education sector still is Moodle because it's free and can be adapted. open. So that's what I know. But as far as tools are concerned,
we did
all these podcasts about it in German, obviously, since the interpreter, where you can listen in and get the details.
From my school,
I have known it's learning as well. So there seem to be various things in use.
The question that is mainly about privacy or data protection,
do you believe that GDPR is an obstacle to distance learning? No. Why should it be?
Warum? Also, wir haben jetzt aktuell, jetzt glaube ich, MS Teams.
Quite often we have MS Teams now, don't we? Es gibt some people are still using Zoom.
Aber wir haben jetzt aktuell,
we've been running 4 days of RC3 using Jitsi servers and Big Blue Button. These things do not record anything, nothing remains. If I host that on a server that is controlled by the school, where is the problem? If the Moodle runs on a server hosted or controlled by the school, it would not be an issue. The privacy issue I see mainly if people use commercial solutions, but then you have something like It's Learning, with which you can have a contractual relationship, and you can decide what you put in there. As a user, I know myself that you can decide, you have a name and an avatar. And it's completely okay to have, if I'm not going to solve, put solutions to tasks in there. That is much safer than having the solutions sent to me via email. But out there we have these MS Teams users, those that store everything on clouds, and there's a lot of school administrative software that runs on clouds, because schools have been thinking, I could just enter my grades at home at leisure, and that's where things get nasty, because you have this software that has grades, and maybe remarks about learning difficulties and other issues. So these percentages of how many people have a problem because you have to dyslexia and things, you have to use that information in grading, and that is information that is sensitive. And you have chain mail functions that you may use with complete data sets. We've seen that. So that is a very different world. And distance learning, that's all very well possible without issues. Privacy can be preserved. The learning platform, this commercial It's Learning stuff, there's no issue there. People get their credentials from the school. You don't even need to have an email address. Yeah, but particularly in homeschooling, you have various worlds clashing there,
wo dann irgendwie ziemlich
various actors that have to arrange things between them. And there are, and another question was about new rules. Did you know that new routines, new rules are established? How do you motivate students that have been spending so much time on YouTube? I'm quoting here. how do you activate your students? Well, the classical response is, as a teacher, you can always have extrinsic motivation through grades.
So zynisch das klingt. Also ich
and
habe natürlich
of course, I have people that want to receive their examination paper, their graduation paper from me. So there is a motivation. I am not working at a school where schooling is obligatory, because these people are in professional education. But if young people like to consume YouTube,
ich schätze da ja so einen Tipp.
Well, there are learning videos on YouTube. Right?
It's so.
So, a concept there, right? some physical exercises in between two. So, what I really find difficult, I'll have to see how to put this to make it come out right. The mode in which we are right now, 3/4 of 90 minutes of sitting in front of a computer, I think that this video conferencing thing
neigen sehr zum Couch Potato sein.
Gets people to become couch potatoes,
and gets people into a consumer attitude. Gemacht, dass du als
I've found that as a teacher I talk and talk and talk, ne? So, so this is hyperfrontal, and everyone else has their microphones and cameras switched off,
und im Zweifel dich auch
and maybe even muted me, so that I won't get on their nerves. So being there is the actual requirement, and that is being checked.
And
to motivate people, you have to give them a task beforehand and then give them an occasion to talk and then have that conversation as long as it's needed. But that gets us to the flexibility issue again. Because you have to communicate that a video conference that is just 15 minutes long, ultimately may achieve more than the 45-minute presence learning because the actual work was done beforehand, when you were not present. And yeah, there is a question to the chat that's quite fitting here. Have you maybe seen literature that you would recommend about didactical models that could connect to this perhaps? I was afraid of that question. I don't really know. There is a lot. What I can recommend is to search Twitter using the hashtag TWLZ, which is German for Twitter Classroom, Twitter Lehrerzimmer. I am quite a self-learning person here. Through my nerd way, I'm in a mode that seems very natural to me, so I haven't really dealt with much of that. And of course, everyone is learning from everyone, but the hashtag is a good recommendation, at least for the German speakers as interpreter, because there's a lot of recent stuff here. Speaking of practical tips,
a question about parents who
want to understand what works in a classroom and what doesn't work. So when it comes about having teachers that can be reached.
Also, generell, ich würde von meiner Schule mindestens eine E-Mail-Adresse verlangen, die funktioniert.
I would ask for everyone to have an email address.
Ich würde mal so für Erreichbarkeit sagen, online Eltern.
I would at least ask for an email address.
And über so, Videoplattformen sollten eigentlich auch
so parents Moment, meeting with a video conference should also be possible. And if you go to school with a camera and do it in the office instead of at home, that's okay. And you can also ask that of the students. But if there are really legal requirements, at least in Bavaria, and I really have to within a certain number of hours in class to offer contentful classes, and it's very hard to measure, but there should be some progress, there's some progression. And if you see that every week, for example, I get two worksheets and they all look the same, and I could also find them on a well-known website, then I have a problem. But what has been established at our school during the learning platforms is to have week plans, to ask for week plans from the teachers, and then to say, for example, this week we want to have a plan for 1 week, and they help the teachers and the students a lot, because then it's clear that within a week at this point in time I have to hand it in, and then I can use the time flexibly. Right, and I think that's maybe the best way, and it's a good to learn self-motivation and learn to work by myself for later in life. Do you think when you want to educate them to more working for themselves, do you think that's maybe a good idea to teach them during the pandemic? Yes, they have to learn that.
Ich hab's mehrfach im Talk schon angesprochen.
We have a problem with our school socialization, and I always hear, especially during the lower classes, even in mandatory schools, and it's not just in Montessori schools, but it becomes more free. And for example, for the first 2 or 3 hours, you can make your own schedule. And the condition is that you must do something, but what you do and for what task and in which group, and you can decide for yourselves. And these are good models. But the problem is I'm sitting at the end of the school system in my kind of school. I have 16, 17, 18 year old students, and in the end they will fail doing it because they have learned it and they have been taught it differently. It's a question of socialization. And if now in the primary schools and in the 5th, 6th, 7th class, they learn that now. And if they really do classes exactly like this, but then in the secondary schools, they break it again, and they are the didactical breaks between the schools. And I can see that I see that our demands are like in grammar schools, and it's not well received because people are not used to working by themselves and motivating themselves. So another short question. So new forms of classes, new forms of education. Do you know something that people can support? No. Really, no, there are lots of people out there working on the topic, and I think most of the things actually are good, and I found everything out by myself, and I'm not in a club or something like that, and I don't know, I couldn't really think of anything right now. As I looked at EduLabs, maybe, and they're doing open source, and Chaos macht Schule, Chaos for Schools also does great things. Yeah, there's lots of things.
Genau.
And thank you again for Thomas for lots of input for this really challenging school year. Dear Thomas, thank you for being a part of the first remote chaos experience, and keep up the good fight. Yes, thank you. Yeah, my pleasure.